Good afternoon. My name is Li Ji Wong from the Pediatric Department of the Samsung Medical Center. First, I would like to thank for the invitation to be part of this event. And second, I would like to speak about the state-of-the-art knowledge in the treatment of solid cancer. Please allow me to say a couple of words about Medical Center Samsung. This is a specialized center of 2,000 beds and daily. Our patients are out, 9,000 outpatients come to us. And we have 6 professors, 2 fellows, 4 residents, and 2 interns. All in all, 14 doctors are people who work in our pediatric department. 2 nursing specialists, 34 nurses, 1 pediatric pharmacist, and 1 social worker, and other supporters. All of us are multidisciplinary team. In the stem cell pediatric department, we have 10 beds. In the center of outpatients department, we have 15 beds. This is pediatric stem cell transplantation unit for 10 beds with high-dose chemotherapy, allogenic stem cell transplantation with for children with leukemia. Children pediatric oncology center, this is how it looks like. We have ambulatory care center, 15 beds for chemotherapy in outpatients mode without necessity to be hospitalized. Now let's see a video trailer about us.
소암 재발암 치료에 좀 특화되어 있습니다. 고용량 화학요법 자가조혈무섭 이식을 연속적으로 시행하는 방법으로 여러 고위험 종양의 치료 성적을 향상시켰는데 대표적으로 고위험 신경 모세포종의 생존율을 약 70%까지 향상을 시켰습니다. 또 그뿐만 아니라 이런 치료 방법을 고위험 뇌종양에서도 적용을 해서 생존율을 향상시켰는데 대표적인 예가 수모세포종이라는 종양이 생존율을 70% 이상으로 향상을 시켰고 또 가장 난치성 뇌종양인 영유아 뇌종양의 치료 성적을 방사선 치료를 최소화하면서도 생존율을 역시 약 70% 정도로 향상을 시켰습니다. 이 분야의 생존율은 우리 병원이 세계에서 가장 좋은 병원이라고 말씀드릴 수 있습니다.
Now I will briefly tell you about the characteristics of cancer in children. Oncology tumors that happen in children are very much different from the cancers that we observe in adults. The nature of tumor in children is completely different from the one in adults. In the majority of cases, the response is positive and the survival rates are quite good. In the treatment of pediatric oncology disorders, especially in the if we speak about courses of chemotherapy, we need to pay attention to control over the further complications and try to minimize the adverse events. Treatment of pediatric solid tumors is done by 3 methods: surgical treatment, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy. Overall, the outcomes are good enough, but in high-risk or recurrent tumors group, the outcomes are quite poor and leave much to be desired. We should not forget about the late adverse events that may be very significant. So first, we need to improve the high-dose chemotherapy and autologous stem cell transplantation in patients of high-risk groups, and also hemopoietic stem cells and chemotherapy regimens can be revised. Another approach is to apply new methods of treatment, proton therapy, targeted therapy, or genome profiling of the tumor for more personalized treatment. Today, I will tell you about the neuroblastoma of high-risk brain tumors, on which our department specializes. Also, I will speak about the platform for precision medicine. Let's start with high-risk neuroblastoma. If we neglect brain tumor, neuroblastoma is the most prevalent solid tumor in children. In standard treatment in the high risk or middle risk groups, the results are quite good. But in the situation of high risk groups, the treatment outcomes in standard chemotherapy are not high. To improve the treatment outcomes in patients of high-risk neuroblastoma starting from the 1990s, late 90s, we developed high-dose chemotherapy. If compared to standard treatment modalities, the results improved significantly, but nonetheless, with single autologous stem cell transplantation, the outcomes were quite poor. Starting from the 21st century, in Samsung Medical Center, we started tandem transplantation twice in a row. Basing upon this experience, we published research devoted to this type of transplantation, which stated improved treatment outcomes are up to 60% in high-risk neuroblastoma patients. Starting from the year 2004, we started registering patients in order to carry out research. These are results of our SMCMB protocol in 2004. So during the second transplantation, we also did the whole total body radiation. And as a result, the five-year survival improved up to 70%. But also, the frequency of late adverse events also increased. So starting from the year 2009, during the second transplantation, instead of total body radiation, we developed new high-dose MIBG therapy protocol. That was the first case of MIBG high-dose and transplantation. If you compare protocols of 2004 and 2009, you will notice a difference in the second transplantation, the shift between TBR to MIBG therapy. Usually, the high-dose MIBG treatment for high-risk neuroblastoma, but of late, usually it is applied for recurrent, and at the moment it is also used for first diagnosed neuroblastoma in high-risk groups. This therapy, first of all, results in less late effects if compared to TBR. But as radioactive substances are used for therapy, we need to isolate these patients. This is the protocol of 2009 and the treatment outcomes. If you compare TBI and MIBG, the difference was not marked. But if you compare it to the protocol of 2004, then it, we can verify that in the case of patients which undergo protocol 2009, the late effects or late complications rate was reduced. So MIBG instead of TBR is a good option, which allows us to keep the treatment outcomes for quite long and reduces the late complications. Starting from 2014, the protocols were modified. Before high-dose chemotherapy, we also do the checkup of the response to treatment, according to which the dose is adjusted. Also, we conduct the clinical trials. If a patient has quite good response to treatment before the onset of high-dose chemotherapy, the dose was down-regulated. If the patient had poor response, then we did not modify the dose. And initially, we planned high-dose chemotherapy, which was continued. So in patients with good response in the reduction of dose, the results of protocol 2014, if compared to the protocol 2009, were not worse. And also in the other group, we demonstrated improvement, improved survival. Death rate was significantly reduced if compared to the protocol of 2009. If you sum up conventional chemotherapy and it accounted to a survival rate of 10-20%. Single HDCT order transplantation was 30-40%. Tandem transplantation resulted in 60-70%. In our hospital, tandem transplantation was started in the beginning of 2000s. And at the moment, MC Samsung results of treatment account for 70% of survival rate. In the situation of relapsing neuroblastoma, we also do the allogenic SCT and high-dose MIBG treatments. If you look at the treatment outcomes in the relapsing neuroblastoma, even after high-dose chemotherapy, the results were not satisfactory. But we managed to improve the treatment outcomes in patients with good response to induction therapy or in group where haplo-identical transplantation of stem cells was conducted, including IMBG treatment. Further, let's speak about the high-risk brain tumors. Among treatment modalities, here we can see surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy. We know that pediatric cancers, they usually are associated with better outcomes than in adults, but late effects among the high-risk groups, we still have a very unfavorable situation here. Another problem is that the treatment outcomes are not, not optimal as well. And very frequently, embryological type of tumors occur in children, which particularly result in craniospinal RT with late complications. In my hospital, we subject these patients to proton therapy, which actually provide us with good treatment outcomes. And another advantage is less adverse events, particularly in children with less radiation of the adjacent healthy tissue. High-risk brain tumors, we apply the following strategy, proton therapy and tandem transplantation, by means of which we reduce RT. The aim and the primary goal is, first of all, to improve survival and to reduce late complications, which can be the effects of RT. Let's look at a clinical case, medulloblastoma, high-risk medulloblastoma. Medulloblastoma accounts for 20% of childhood brain tumors. So the methods of treatment are surgical intervention plus radiotherapy and plus chemotherapy, as well as craniospinal RT in 36-39 degrees. Sometimes we apply local radiotherapy. But in leptomeningeal metastasis, the residual tumor and the large cell pathology, the prognosis is far from being satisfactory, unlike medulloblastoma. And if you do the craniospinal therapy of 36-39 grays, it will result in cognitive dysfunction. Medical center, Samsung Medical Center, reduce craniospinal RT dose and introduce tandem transplantation. And analyzing this method of treatment, we claim the following results. 10-year survival accounted for 71%. Patients who were on this treatment were provided craniospinal RT with the dose of 23.4 grays up to 30.6. Despite that, the 10-year survival rate accounted for 70%, and there were very low rates of late complications. Also, 10 out of 14 patients over 18 also entered universities after treatment, and 3 out of 5 at the age of 23 jobs and continued good level of everyday functioning. It's quite difficult to treat brain tumors in very young children up to the age of 3. This is related to the fact that the brain is still under development, so RT can result in unacceptable adverse effects. That is why in the treatment of such patients, we first have surgery, then chemotherapy, and only after the age of 3, we apply radiation therapy. But it was actually determined that this disease can progress if you delay RT, which can result in very low survival rate of 20 to 30%. To delay RT to maximum in medical center Samsung, we do tandem transplantation, which improves survival rate and allows us to postpone RT as well as downregulate the dose in order to avoid side effects. The local RT was administered after surgery, chemotherapy and high dose chemotherapy, only in the presence of residual tumor. Craniospinal radiation was provided only if leptomeningeal metastases were present. Otherwise, RT was not given. Nonetheless, it was verified that 7-year-old survival accounted for 60%. The treatment reaction would depend on the type of tumor. Treatment results in ATRT and were not acceptable. In all the other cases, efficacy was there. This is current protocol for embryonal tumors, which is applied in our hospital. According to this protocol, intrathecal chemotherapy is provided to further reduce RT dose, but on RT we provide chemotherapy twice and also we reduce intrathecal chemotherapy once. Then there is one course of craniospinal chemotherapy, 4 courses of chemotherapy, and in the case of high-risk patients, there is tandem transplantation that is provided depending on the presence or metastatic tumor. We also have local and craniospinal radiation therapies. The same comes with the brain tumors of very young children. We provide them surgery, 6 courses of chemotherapy, intrathecal chemotherapy, and tandem transplantation. Then when the child is 3, if there are metastases, we use craniospinal chemotherapy with a dose of 18 gray. So also applying induction therapy if there is positive response, local radiation therapy is provided for 18 months. Further on, I'm going to speak about the precision medicine platform, which is applied in the medical center Samsung. As you know very well, the precision medicine is all about the genetic abnormalities in a particular person and also provision of individualized treatment according to them. The Genome Studies Institution of Samsung Medical Center developed cancer scan platform, which can detect actionable variant in cancer. This platform also provides us with several clinical trials opportunities based on genomics. The number of genes is approximately 25,000. Cancer scan is a diagnostic platform that analyzes mutations in 381 gene, which is related to cancer and prognosis. We start the process from the DNA retrieval from the clinical specimen. Then the retrieved DNA is analyzed by cancer scan platform, which is based upon the developed NGS by the Institution of Genomic Studies of Samsung Medical Center. Thus, the received information on the genome for a particular patient, there is a consensus reached on hematologists, biologists, pathologists, and geneticists come together. The specialists look into each case and they analyze the condition of a patient from all perspectives, selecting the most potent drugs by means of gateway sleuth system, another development of the Samsung Medical Center laboratories. The clinical physician can check the genome analysis on the internet and use this to plan individualized targeted treatment for patients. The cancer scan platform and information about it, as well as the different clinical cases, are published as research results. Such results are usually assessed as a high academic value. Initially, cancer scan was used in all cases, but mainly it is applicable in the situation of adult cancer. As the pediatric cancer is different by genomics, by markers and the stratification risk markers, that is why we need separate panel for pediatric cases. Apart from that, there is another important aspect about pediatric patients. There is a gene which makes children prone to cancer, which can occur in approximately 10% of children. Also, PET scan is another platform that we developed, which can also evaluate a number of genes. And this includes 353 genes, including 149 cancers predisposing to cancer. There was an article published which allows us to detect active, actionable genetic alterations. So in the use of such platforms, we conducted a clinical trial for refractory, relapsed, or relapsing pediatric solid tumors. The clinical trials were initiated in 2016, and all in all, we registered approximately 84 patients. 84 patients were enrolled. The clinical trials were designed the following way. First of all, there were just samples of solid tumors, and sequencing was done. Then for a month, they analyzed active genome variants. In the presence of this, we added drugs which are active in this particular variant. If there are absence of them, then multi-TKA was provided. In some patients, we verified good results with the multi-TKIs and also active variants of genes. And apart from that, in some patients, there was partial or full remissions they reached. At the moment, in relapsing high-risk pediatric cancers, we do sequencing and data analysis. Then expert panel review is done, and report is drawn. Basing upon this report, we do different clinical trials based on genomics, either as compassionate use program, and also all this is done within the precision medicine platform. Now let's look at several cases. A patient with inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. With the use of FISH method, fluorescent hybridization did not show any translocation, but in the with the use of PET scan, we found translocation ALK-PM4. In the case of this patient, the standard treatment did not result in tumor shrinking. After ALK translocation, we used crizotinib within 4 weeks, and after week two, there was complete response to treatment. Up to now, this patient has no signs of disease. Another sign, patient with refractory neuroblastoma. PET scan after also ALKF1174L was a mutation was detected and ALK amplification. As it was generally known that this is a species that is resistant to ALK inhibitors, we asked for lortatinib, which is second generation by Pfizer Oncology, as a compassionate use. So we applied this in this case, and the tumor disappeared in 8 weeks after relapse. Case number three, patient with low-grade glioma, standard treatment but after PET scan, we found BRAF fusion, BRAF fusion, after which MEK inhibitors were administered, condition improved. PET scan platform is used not only for treatment, but also to find out the predisposition syndrome, genetic counseling, as well as follow-up. Allow me to show an example. Let's look at a patient 4 years of old, a girl with initial renal sarcoma. After nephrectomy, we found, diagnosed undifferentiated sarcoma. In 5 years after, a patient had a tumor in the brain and a cyst in another kidney, a contralateral kidney. Relapse of a sarcoma in the head is very rare, so that's why we suppose that it's a completely different type of cancer. But the post-surgical analysis shows that it was a certain relationship with the primary tumor. We had certain suspicions of these results, and we decided to conduct NGC and germline sequencing. So DICER1 nonsense mutation. Then we know that renal sarcoma can develop, and cysts or nephromas. So after that, we did sequencing for each of the tumors separately. As genome sample was different, we had opinions that that was the secondary but tumor, that not the relapse. The genetic counseling showed that the mother had similar mutation. We followed up. So this is the end of my talk. And so the takeaway messages are the following. We can improve survival rates and minimize late effects, such as with new methods such as targeted therapy, proton therapy, genomics, and as a platform to screen actionable variants, as well as clinical trials. But clinical trials are needed to bring down the late complications in pediatric patients. Thank you very much for your attention.